Hello everyone, I'm Franco Vergomi. Guillaume Gébart will be joining us, I think, at the moment of the Q&A. Yes, I work in Thales Alenia Space. You'll see later what we do in this company. I've been doing modeling since 2006 when I started working. And I was there when Sirius was born in Thales. So now I've been using Sirius for at least 10 years, and I will. So this talk is about how we are using Sirius and all other technologies to set up a software factory for my domain, which is space systems, and how we work together with Guillaume in order to build this kind of software factory, and how to. I will try to give you some hints and advices on how to structure and organize your engineering environments in order to have flexibility and all kind of properties like extensibility and customizability. So I'm very happy to be here. The talks are very interesting. I'm used to follow talks and sit and be relaxed. So, but it was time for me to to show what we are doing. So thank you for the invitation, and now let's start the presentation. So, okay, so this is the plan. So I will first go through a little bit of context so that you understand where we are, what we do, and then we'll dive into the software factory, how it is built, what are the stakes, and then a little bit of future and the conclusion. So first, so Thales Group. Thales Group is where Guillaume works. So Thales Group is a major actor in the system engineering and system industry. They work in diverse domains such as cyber security, ground transportation, aerospace, defense, and also space. And yes, it's a large company, very international. With a large footprint and a major footprint in France, but also in Europe and all the other continents. Thales Alenia Space, so the place where I am working, is a joint venture between Thales and its Italian counterpart that is called Leonardo. So we are mostly part of Thales, and that's why we are able to, you'll see, to share some engineering environments, engineering solutions with the rest of the group of Thales. So Thales Alenia Space, what we do is we essentially we are building space systems, so satellites for telecommunication, for defense, for observation, but also for navigation such as the GNSS or Galileo. And we are building also systems that go a bit further than the Earth, so around Mars or also, we're starting to build systems around the moon for the Gateway project, so the Artemis project. So, to be more precise, I am working in the onboard software department. So, the onboard software, what is it? It's the software that are onboard the space system. So, they are both in the system payload, software satellite payload. So, the payload is what the satellite is made for, to observe, to do some telecommunication. And there is also the platform software that the job of the platform is to put the satellite on the right spot in the appropriate orbit with the appropriate position, attitude, to feed the satellite with sufficient energy from the solar arrays, etc., 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 do the thrust operations, etc. So these software are at least they are bit complex because they have to interact with a lot of equipment, and we are facing here the situation where we have to share also the effort of development of the software with the partners. So the architecture of the software is really key, and there is a lot of protocol of exchanges. So we tend to automate as much as possible the code production. I tell you a bit more about that later. So how it is done and how do we build software factories between a global company, Thales Group, and let's say a specialty company such as Thales Alenia Space that deals with the space systems. So in the Thales Group, there is a team, a big department, which is a transverse to all the businesses, which develops or assembles, buys, or and deploys engineering environment, integrated engineering environment. So it's made of you may know Capella, the system engineering workbench, which was first developed in Thales, then put as an open source so that other industrial can contribute and use, and now it's fully open source. We have the equivalence for software engineering, for component-based software engineering. So I will tell you a bit more later. It's called Melody CCM. And then they provide all sorts of all other environments for requirements, etc. And of course, and luckily for us, they provide SDK, so a development kit, to extend this engineering environment. So for instance, if you know Capella, you may know Capella Studio that allows you to define extensions for Capella. So we have the same for Melody CCM and for all the other environments. The delivery pace is not very fast. There is one main delivery containing all the tools compatible and integrated per year, and a lot of many patches every year. In my site, so in Thales Alenia Space, we receive these deliveries, and then we steer the changes. We try to influence it with its roadmap so that the evolutions fit our needs. But we also, and this is normal, we extend and we customize these environments because they are generic, and we have to make them productive for our domain. And of course, we deploy them to operational projects and provide support. So in my side, what we deliver is called the model-based system and software factory. So you'll see the system and software in a few slides. So Guillaume is the guy providing me the Melody CCM, and I am the guy with a bunch of colleagues providing the system factory in Thales Alenia Space. So this is an overall schema telling exactly what I was explaining to you. So Guillaume develops environments. We here, we develop it, we develop extensions, or we reuse what Guillaume provides us, or customize, we compose. So all the technologies we use have to provide the appropriate extension possibilities. And then we assemble this environment and deploy it to all the projects. We use it to build, to define, to design, and to develop their own software, and then put it on the satellite and start the dream. So why using modeling for our software in Thales Group? So first, we are using a component-based software engineering. This is very interesting because using a component-based approach allows to separate concerns, to have formal boundaries, to clearly identify the interfaces. And this is very helpful when you work with partners, because you can say, okay, this component, you will develop it, but these are the interfaces, and we both understand exactly the same interface. There's no ambiguity. And also the ability to be able to replace a component with one which conforms to exactly the same interfaces, and reuse components from one project to another one, or interfaces or data as libraries, as you would do with code, etc. So for component-based software engineering, there is one main player which is very standardized, and most software vendors know it, is the CCM component model. So it comes from very old world, from CORBA. It's an OMG standard, so it's well-founded. It has been discussed between a lot of industrials, so it's safe in terms of concepts and in terms of stability. And it has been extended with a lot of additional concepts to provide additional interaction patterns between components, such as publish, subscribe, etc., which are much more interesting and efficient than call and answer, etc. And there is also the same extensions for deployment and configuration. So MDE is modeling is a perfect fit for a CBSC, because we start from very clear set of concepts, with a stable definition, and then it's really easy to have a meta model of this standard and to make a visual tool that allows to express an architecture. So this is why it's really straightforward to match these two words. So yes, so Thales and Guillaume, they build and they maintain Melody CCM, which is a CCM based software design environment. So it is using, it helps you define software architecture using the CCM component model. So CCM component models comes with a lot of capabilities to define data interfaces, components, assemble it, etc. So this is done obviously with Sirius for the graphical part. So this is kind of diagram that we have. These are class diagrams. So it may look like something that you can see in UML sometimes. These are component and interfaces diagram, so where you define exactly the contracts that a component is using or providing in terms of services or events or other kind of patterns. Then you can instantiate your components and connect them really. So these are really the instances, and deploy them on a node. So I show you part of the diagrams here. And then this makes a full chain from types to implementations and to instances. So this is fully made with Sirius, EMF, if Axelio to generate the code, etc. So this is what Guillaume provides us. It's it provides also other kinds of representations, but I wanted to show this one because they are the most easy ones to see. So as I told you before, a Melody CCM is based on, of course, EMF. There are many meta models which are composed, and this is done, and all the overall generation of the Java code is done, is let's say orchestrated with EMF generation factories, EGF. Of course, we use Axelio for the code generation from the model, and Kit Alpha, which provides a set of interesting technologies to set up validation rules, to architecture properly code generators or model transformations. And of course, for the graphical part, we use a Sirius and if. The architecture of Melody CCM is really very modular. As I told you, there are several meta models that are composed. And same thing for all the views. I showed you data, component types, and implementations, and instances. All these are separate viewpoints, actually, if you look at it. But when you are using the tool, you don't see it. But this helps to easily extend or customize or reuse parts of the modeler without having all the dependencies or having the burden to deal with complex dependencies. This helps the reuse. The extension is really made easy because it's very precise where you extend. So thanks to this granularity, both on Guillaume's side, who is delivering the tool, and on my side, which I am installing it, we are able to play with the granularity and deploy just a part or all or something, not all the software, and then to build our really to tailor the environment to really what the user needs. No excessive, no additional stuff, no separate, no, yeah, nothing more, nothing less, just exactly what he needs. So on my side, so of course, we are receiving all the delivery from the group, so Thales group, so the Capella Melody CCM. And we are building a continuous toolchain. So we are not alone in the software domain to do models. There are other colleagues in other domains who use models too. And so there is no sense to keep silos separated. So we try to as much work in a continuous process. So there is a large upstream system engineering activity done with Capella. So at system level, then subsystem, etc., where my software really appears as a box. And these models can be very interesting for us because they give a lot of context around what the software is doing, what it is connected with, etc. So there is something that we can transform to our software domain. Of course, on our software side, the CBST and modeling and LDCM is used for its productivity, not only to do drawings, but the model is really productive. And to give you a figure, we generate between 50 and 70% of the global code which is on board the satellite. So it's really important. And the code we generate, we really don't want to write it by hand. It would be a really big mistake. We made a lot of errors. So yeah, productivity is key. So we use MelodyCCM. So we have a customization of MelodyCCM with additional code generators because they are made for our specific domain. And we call it CCM for space. And then, of course, there may be need for some components which are a bit large in terms of complexity to have the detailed design of the internal of the components of how it is implemented. So it's the design of the code. So this is used. This is done with UML with a profile. So we use UML designer, which is also done with Sirius. And also we try to push forward the modeling. So since the models of the software are really precise and they tell the truth, we can use it as a basis to prepare the validation. So the integration and the validation and verification of the software. So we have an internal tool called Vivo. I will show you some images of it that allows to set up your validation and integration strategy and identify what you test with what. So as I told you, this tool chain, this continuous tool chain is really important. The continuity is really is mandatory because it justifies the effort that someone can do at the system level, and it benefits to the software and so on. So it's really a teamwork, and to do all these extensions, it is really key that the basis, so MelodyCCM and Capella, be very clean in terms of extensibility, in terms of viewpoints, etc. So this is extending such this kind of tools is really only possible when two conditions are met, in my opinion. So the first one is if they use the good set of technologies, you will be able to benefit from these technologies. And if these technologies have the right, the appropriate properties, you will benefit from them. So of course, Sirius has a lot of interesting benefits for extensibility, reuse, etc. So it's a good thing that they use Sirius so that I can extend it. And the clean foundations, it's really, you cannot cope with that. If you don't have clean foundations for a tool, extending it is really a nightmare. So thank you, Guillaume, for having, and the entire group for having set up the good foundations, because it's really very, very comfortable for us and easy for us to extend and to add things where we want them to be added. So a few minutes around how we extend Capella and the MelodyCCM. So if you know Capella, so Capella comes with a large set of diagrams, much more than a MelodyCCM, with a functional analysis, logical architecture, physical architecture, all kinds of diagrams from structural diagrams to a sequence diagram. So here, for the system and software co-engineering activities, we need to understand the same thing in the Capella model, us from the software and them from the system, and to be a team and to really able to exchange and to understand the same thing. So we have defined a viewpoint which comes over Capella and adds more information on existing diagrams. So here you can see there are some little tags that are put that have a specific meaning. Here too, you see there are little letters that are put on this class diagram. And we also provide additional views or representation that help focus on some aspects of what is designed in Capella. Here, for instance, we see the decomposition of data. It's like if you unfold the class and you see the children of the children, and it helps make some verifications, identify some problems. And this is really key for co-engineering, because you are talking not in front of diagrams and you have to open 10 diagrams. You just unfold the data and everyone understands the same thing, and it's very easy to focus on the problems, etc. And here, additional views that are really dedicated to our domain, but that are very key for what we are doing together. So this is an example of how we extend the system engineering to fit software concerns, and then do this co-engineering so that you make sure that the system model is really good for us, and we'll be able to transform it in software, and we have no additional work, at least on this information. In the same way, we extended the Melody system with additional diagrams, with layers, etc. UML, we don't need to extend it because it comes with its the profiles and tag value, so we don't need to add layers or whatever, because the UML diagrams were fitted for us. And we have additional, so this is kind of a UML view. It's not the latest. And we have also additional viewpoints and views that allows us to work on specific aspects of the software architecture, more on the timing, on the tasking, etc. Still by reusing parts of the viewpoints defined in Melody CCM. So this is kind of a reusing parts of mappings that are defined in your design. Just to show you how we push forward for other concerns than just software architecture. So this is for the validation. Here is an environment that we have set up that allows us to define the structure of the strategy of integration and validation process. So it's a basic serious view diagram, and we have also the ability to identify against the design that we've made with Melody CCM, so with the software components, what we are testing. So it's in terms of parameters. So maybe at first you test one component and then two, three, four. So we have the ability to select what we are testing and with what. So the with what are also components, of course, which are seen as mirrors or stubs. And these, if you look carefully, they are exactly the same mappings that were used in the software design environment. This is thanks to Sirius, because we just reuse the mappings and we say, okay, I just have to add two boxes around, so two containers, and inside I reuse the components, so just the one that I selected. And this is really, really easy to set up. We didn't have to redefine nothing. So this is a very big advantage, and this is, you see, that are the people that are doing the validation. There is a really continuity, not only in terms of reusing an architecture, but also reusing the same representation. So we see the same thing. Software architect looking at this, he recognizes his components because it's exactly them. So this is the kind of use, and also, yeah, we use, of course, the duality between Xtext and EMF resources. So this we mainly use for scenarios, validation, or scenarios that explain how the system works. So we have a language to define scenarios between our components, and of course, the textual scenario is really cool. When you write it, you control space, it completes, etc. It makes sure that what you write is correct, but you always need a view to have an overview of what is the story between your components. So there is this cool integration between Xtext and Sirius that we've been using at least for five years now. And also we have additional tables. For instance, I show you one here. It's the traceability between to see how requirements are applied over any kind of model. So this is really interesting because it's fully reflexive. Sirius doesn't just knows about the requirements, and but it doesn't know about what model we are putting the requirements on. But it's still easy to define a reflexive table editor. It could be also diagram editor, but this kind of information is good to be seen as a table. So this is the kind of usage that we have our Sirius to set up our software factory. The advantages of Sirius, I told a lot. So if you start from clean foundations, Sirius is really enabling all the extension process. You can adapt really easily graphical models that exist with maybe by using an additional layer or filterings or maybe just by defining your own viewpoint but by reusing parts of existing viewpoints. Integrating and assembling viewpoints is really is easy, and hiding this complexity to the end user is also feasible and possible. Serious comes with a various kind of diagram that covers at least all our needs. So in terms of diagrams, sequence diagrams, tables, or also trees, because sometimes the EMF tree is a bit rich. You don't want to show everything, so you can do little trees just to focus on some special aspects. And the integration with Xtext is also working very correctly. So it shows that Sirius can work with any kind of resource. Should it be an XMI, a CDO, or Xtext, or any your own resource? So it's working fine. And of course, yeah, the properties views that appeared a few years ago, or last year, I don't remember. It's really a good thing because if was good, but defining your property views declaratively without having to move the code, set up the plugin XML is really, really, really cool, really straightforward. So it's a big help. So about the future challenge, in my opinion, so we have been, many people have told about the layout. The layout of components is not really easy, even for ELK. Moving the ports according maybe to their kind, making a diagram which is clean is very difficult to automate. So this is something that may need to be addressed. ELK can do a great job, but of course it's up to us, the guys who make the tools, to help ELK do the ELK, do the right work, and have a very precise definition of how we want the the diagrams to be laid out. This is really difficult to define, at least. The components, when you are assembling instances of components and you have all the connection, of course you end with a spaghetti, but because the system is a spaghetti, so of course the diagrams is honest. And they cannot be nicer than the reality. So maybe we need to figure out a way to have contextual diagrams that filter out all the non-contextual information, maybe to focus on two components or one component and the neighbors, but filtering. But we have to find out a way, rules to fill our diagrams and not put everything. And I think that another challenge is that will come is the mixing of textual and graphical syntaxes. I was convinced that everyone before would be using graphical views to think, to design, etc. But it's not the case. I think that this depends on the cognitive abilities or preferences of every individual. I am a visual guy, so I love diagrams, but some other people, they love text or other kind of approaches, and we need to take this in account. So there is also a kind of fashion now of the doc as code, everything as code, and XMI is not really, is not code, is not easy to read. So we may have to have a dual representations of our models as code and maybe as XMI, and find how to synchronize these two natures. So this is the kind of testimonies that I people that I see that say, okay, I'm super efficient with my keyboard. I love to write text. I love VS Code, VI, Emacs, etc. But of course, I want my text to be consistent, and I want the diagrams for free. So, okay, these are two words that we have to reconcile. People also say, it's very cool. I want to edit the model with my text editor, but I want consistency too. But okay, how do we set up this? So maybe, Serious Web will help when integrating with TIA or VS Code to provide this dual set of views. So the model is we don't care about how it is serialized, but we can show it and manipulate it with a view, a graphical view, but or with a textual view all together. I don't know how much this is difficult to do, but we have to try to tackle this this challenge. So the other challenge is web-based modeling and multi-user. Of course, now we are deploying a fully Eclipse-based environment, so we are struggling with people who don't have the same version. So we are using virtual machines, but it's not really easy to set up virtual machines and to provide access rights. So and it's not really as a service approach. So we may need to start switching to web-based modeling, but will it fit all the needs and all the cases that we're covering with Eclipse? I don't know. So maybe we'll have a mix of a web and traditional environments. So this is a challenge. And of course, I just starting thinking about this is as a service Turing distribution. So today we don't provide it as a service. It's a zip. We unzip it. You use it. It's not as a service. To update it, you have to make sure that all the users in one team, they update at the same time, or they have a particular approach to share one Eclipse, and one of the guys updates the Eclipse for all his colleagues, etc. So it's not easy. So we have to think about how to distribute these tools in a different way, so that everything is deployed as a service. And can it be integrated also in the CI/CD processes? So this is more for the model processing. I think about the code generation, the validation, checks, etc. This we have to figure out a way to integrate it really neatly in the CI/CD approaches. And the last point will be that if we start to be able to deploy and to serve engineering environments as a service, we'll be able to monitor easily who is using what, not to track the usage and understand why what he's designing, but to understand how often one diagram or how often a generator is used, and at which moment, which are the patterns, identify where to put where the value is, and start being able to monetize maybe the tooling in order to fund its deployment, its development, its maintenance, etc. Because today we are based on a very basic business model, at least in my company, and it's not really. I'm not sure that everything is really good, really properly calibrated in this business model. By following how the tool is used, we will be very able to figure out which operations produce value, and so that we can share some benefits. So we reach the conclusion. So just as a takeaway, when you develop, when you provide an engineering environment, it's really unlikely that someone will not extend it. It's be sure that someone will always extend the tool it receives, because he wants to add his particular stuff. So it's really important that every to be extended, so with clean names, and think modular, be modular by constructions, separate all the services by concerns, so that it is easy to pick one part and not the others. Don't have too many dependencies, so that you don't have to grab the whole set of plugins. Okay, this is a difficult things to do, but it's really a good investment, and it really easily will be amortized by your customers or by yourself too, because it will be really easy to maintain your environment. And in the other part, when you're extending an environment, you must be as lazy as possible. You don't redefine anything. You have to try to reuse as much as possible. Keep always the constants separated. And also, very important thing is to think about the storage. if you add in the model, or this is not a drama to set up. We know how to handle different files in the same time. And in terms of graphical representation, it makes absolutely no difference. Sirius will be, you still can be the build the viewpoint as you want. You can show the additional information in your original diagram, even if it is stored elsewhere. So, but it's really important to separate concerns, because you don't want your model to contain all the businesses, all the specialties, and then have a model that needs all the meta models of the world to open. You really want to separate things. And it's really important also that the end user doesn't see the sophistication or the complexity of how the tool is made. It must help you deploy and develop, but it does not cost effort to the end user. Especially when your end user is an architect, a software architect, your tooling architecture must be absolutely perfect. So yeah, one last thing, and I'm done. Okay, we talk a lot about ergonomy, user experience, etc. So what we are building are engineering environments. So I prefer talking about engineering experience. So our users, they are engineers, so they love to see how things are done, and they must be proud of what they are using. It should not be a shame for them to use something or having disgust using a tool. So. The good engineering experience comes when you use a tool that is properly structured, that has the good concepts, that has the good architecture, and that is really flexible. So this is really something that is possible with Sirius if you have the good discipline. I think that we have been able to achieve this kind of success with Guillaume and with our twofold development, deploy process. And I hope this presentation was interesting for all of you.
Thank you, Franco. First questions. Have you considered contributing some of the customization or extension to open source?
So when I was in Thales, we put some part of this customization on open source. It was part of Kitalpha, but it was much more the technological part. So for the model transformation above the viewpoints, no, not yet. The viewpoint, especially on Capella, we know that some parts are really could be interesting for other domains. But for now, we are looking about how to share it in the Thales group for now, because now it is stuck in Thalesenia space. But it could be delivered because it has the good structure.
Okay, thanks. Do you consider that it should be a balance between visual and text integration by using Sirius as a platform for visual DSL solutions?
Yes, I think that as I told before, it's really into how people see their design. I was very convinced by graphical modeling, and now I tend to see advantages also in textual modeling. But I don't want to divide or only one or the other. So I think that we have to bridge this gap. So this is something we tried with by integrating Xtext and Sirius, but it was for scenario modeling. So we didn't have technical ideas on the elements. It was really, it was bijective, but we found out that it was a bit difficult to, at least for sequence diagram, to be as rich in a sequence diagram as you could be in the text. So maybe our case was a bit special. I know that, for instance, it could be very interesting, at least for the interface or data types design, to use a textual syntax. But also, we have to find out how to hide there are many elements that we put in the meta model that are here to for technical reasons, such as the UIDs, the IDs, etc. There are a lot of references that are hidden, but are here for technical reasons, and we don't have to have them in the text because you have the text with ideas everywhere. You don't want to type ideas every time, and I don't know how to hide this in Xtext, or how to reconcile an expression that would not have these ideas with an XML one. I think that this is a serious topic, but it is very important to have this integration between textual and graphical or the traditional way of modeling.